Again, my name is Kevin Yankowsky, and as Sue told you, I'm a partner in Fulbright and Jaworski's health litigation group. What I do with about 75% of my time is defend lawsuits and defend pretty much anyone in healthcare, from individual practitioners to long-term care facilities to acute care networks to pharmaceutical companies, in pretty much any kind of dispute they can become involved in, be it single case litigation, class action litigation, government regulatory problems, etc. About the other 20 to 25% of my time, I try to spend putting myself out of business on the other 75%, which is by going around and working with institutions in healthcare to help them perhaps come up with some ways that will help them prospectively manage their risk a little better and hopefully avoid becoming ensnarled in the legal process to begin with and needing my services as a trial lawyer if they do. I want to thank Medline again for the opportunity to be here. These are fabulous forums and fabulous opportunities to share ideas. And I want to share just a few kind of unique ideas as the token lawyer on the panel today. It's a real privilege to be part of a quality summit. There's really nothing more important in healthcare at any time, especially now, than the pursuit of quality. And I noticed, you know, that the subtitles of the sessions are, you know, meeting the changing expectations of quality and growing expectations for quality of patients and family. And certainly, I guarantee you, you've all heard lots and lots of wonderful ideas about how to do that over the course of the last day and a half. But, and here comes the but. Unfortunately, I'm here to tell you that no matter what you do in terms of improving your quality and meeting those expectations, the simple, sad reality is that you will never be able to convey that message of quality in a non-diluted form to your patient population. And the simple reason for that is that there are a number of people out there who have a dedicated financial interest in making sure your patients do not hear that message. Take a look at just a few things that long-term care facility patients hear. I took these either from online advertisements or from just Yellow Pages advertisements in my home state of Texas for plaintiff's attorneys basically looking for lawsuits to file against long-term care. Take a look at some of this language here. Look at the wording that's used. Developing bed sores are abuse. Long-term care facilities treat residents like cattle. You don't see this type of language in most advertisements for litigation. For example, even in healthcare, you don't see the idea that if someone develops an intraoperative infection, they've been abused. You don't see the concept that pediatric hospitals treat children like cattle. And yet you do see this in long-term care litigation. And there's a simple reason for this, is that there's a lot of money still at stake here, and a lot of reasons for plaintiff's lawyers to spin the story this way in terms of the quality being provided by long-term care. I want to share with you just a few current statistics on reported verdicts and settlements in long-term care wound care litigation. This is not the whole universe of long-term care litigation. It's just wound care, which is, as I'm sure all of you know, a large percentage of the types of litigation that long-term care faces. The average reported award is over $4 million. And if you look at the highest awards over the last 5 years, I'll give you some idea of some of the jackpots, so to speak, that are out there for plaintiffs' attorneys. Couple of little quick notes on this. One, these are all in the last 5 years, which is after the wave of so-called tort reform has hit the country and presumably reduced some of these awards. Two, look at the geographic distribution here. We're looking at major awards really in a lot of different regions of the country, in a lot of different urban centers, under a lot of different state laws. And three, one thing that's important to note is in a lot of cases and in a lot of jurisdictions, tort reform has actually made litigation against long-term care more financially advantageous for plaintiffs' lawyers in certain respects. For example, in a lot of jurisdictions, there are caps on recoverable damages in healthcare liability claims as part of tort reform. An exception to those caps often involves injuries to elderly individuals. And most of your plaintiffs in long-term care suits are, of course, elderly individuals. So We have a situation where the law of unintended consequences has sometimes made the pursuit of litigation against long-term care even more advantageous, even more exciting for plaintiffs' attorneys than it was before tort reform. I'll talk a little bit about what I see as maybe a potential new avenue of liability for long-term care, and that's what's called strict liability. Basically, that means liability without fault. It's a very well-accepted legal concept. If it applies to your event and your lawsuit, you're liable merely because the event occurred. You're liable despite the fact that you acted reasonably and even despite the fact that you may have acted in an exemplary fashion. Believe it or not, this is a very common doctrine, and we see it a lot in situations we don't really think about. Speeding laws, for example, are strict liability laws. It doesn't matter if you had to go to the bathroom. It doesn't matter if you were late for a meeting. If you're speeding, you're speeding. You're liable because the event occurred. In most states, statutory rape laws, inappropriate sexual conduct with minor laws are strict liability laws. It doesn't matter if you say, well, he had a beard or he had a college ID, or he told me he was 30. You know, if he's 15, he's 15, and the law says you're liable no matter what. Federal and state statutes and regulations are a common source for this type of liability, and where I think long-term care needs to be concerned is with the potential application of the new never events statutes. As these quality statutes are coming into effect and as the publication of never events and the concept of never events becomes more widespread, I'm personally convinced you're going to see at least attempts to make pressure ulcer litigation into strict liability litigation. For simply saying, because the ulcer developed, it is a never event. It should not have developed. We don't need to worry about the quality of care. The simple fact that it did develop means that the nursing home, the acute care facility, whatever it might be, should be liable. Now, that's not really what the statute says, and I could talk for a long time about why it's not what the statute says, but from a risk standpoint, I think that's out there, and I think it's something you need to be aware of. If that wasn't enough, I want to tell you a little bit about a real case that really happened. This was in 2008, late 2008. A Hawaii nursing home operator was convicted of manslaughter over the death of a patient. Now, this, before you get too scared, this was the company. Well, we're not talking about the individual manager of a nursing home that was put in jail, but the company was criminally convicted here. This happened again in 2009 in Connecticut, so this is not an isolated incident. And I want to show you a quote here. This is not the quote from a plaintiff's lawyer or someone involved in suing nursing homes. This is the quote from the medical examiner who assisted the state's prosecution. We now have the criminal law as a weapon against poor long-term care nursing care. Now, if that doesn't get your attention, I don't know what else I can say that might. That is truly terrifying. So, what do you do? The simple and logical first answer is, well, what can I do to avoid being sued? I'm going to do everything I can to do that, and I'm going to start with providing the highest quality care I can. And I would say to you that is exactly the right first impression, and that is exactly the right place to start, but that won't get you there. Interestingly, the University of Michigan did a study about a year and a half ago where they looked at wound care litigation in the state of Michigan. They looked retrospectively at lawsuits that were filed over pressure ulcers and other wounds, which predominantly involved long-term care facilities. And here's what they found, looking back retrospectively at the cases. Nearly 2 out of 3 of those cases did not involve a discernible act of negligence, a discernible error or omission in the care, and yet those cases were filed. Now, it doesn't mean the plaintiffs won all those cases. It doesn't mean they all went to trial. It doesn't even mean they all settled. But they all were filed, and every one of those institutions and every one of those healthcare providers had to go to the time, the expense, the aggravation, the embarrassment, the stress of being involved in the legal process. So what can you conclude from this? Quite simply, improving your care will only go so far, and it will not in and of itself eliminate or even sufficiently minimize, in my judgment, the legal and the medical legal risk you face inherently because of the fact that you're in the long-term care business. So, what do we do in addition to improving the quality of our care? A couple of years ago, when we were working on the paper that Sue mentioned, we came up with the idea of preventative legal care. This was kind of a takeoff on the advice that the medical community is constantly giving non-medical people, which is to really engage in preventative medical care, really look at things prospectively. A couple of years ago, I guess it's been a year and a half ago now, I was privileged to speak at another one of these conferences that Medline put on in Washington, D.C., where Tom Daschle spoke. And when speaking about the healthcare system in this country, he talked about how we have a pyramid that's inverted. He said we really should have a pyramid where the broad base is on efforts and money and resources towards prevention, and the narrow tip is on treatment, is on actual treatment of illness and treatment of acute disease, when in actuality the pyramid's the opposite, and that's the problem in this country. I liked that analogy so much I've stolen it, and I've used it every time I've spoken since I heard that, because I think it applies equally well to how we handle medical legal risk in this country. Instead of having a pyramid where we spend lots and lots of resources trying to prospectively prevent medical legal risk, we spend an enormous amount of research of resources and time on legal fees and on settlements and on trials and on depositions and on all of the associated expenses that go towards actively, aggressively defending lawsuits once they happen. So what we wanted to propose is that healthcare providers take a more prospective approach to managing litigation risks. Now let me stress, overall, this is not a substitute for improved clinical care. This is not a lawyer up here trying to tell you how you can weasel out of being responsible if you provide bad care to some of your residents or some of your patients. What I am here to try to suggest to you is that there are certain things you can do to minimize your litigation risks that are not directly associated with the quality of your care. The litigation risks that led to those 66% of the lawsuits in the University of Michigan study that I just showed you a little while ago. So, in a nutshell, what are we talking about with preventative legal care? In the time I've got, I can just talk about some of the basics, but I do want to hit on three very important topics: communication, documentation, and mitigation. The first thing when you think about preventing a lawsuit is you really need to understand how a lawsuit develops. How does someone get to the point where they file a lawsuit and they sue a long-term care facility? Well, there's really two timelines to think about. There's the treatment timeline, where you have an admission and then you have a key event. If you don't have an event, you're not going to have a lawsuit. No one goes home happy and suddenly decides they're just going to sue just because they just want to sue somebody. The event's recognized, people are notified of the event, there's treatment, and then there's a discharge, or in some cases, if the patient expires, there's a death. And then you have a medical legal timeline. After the event occurs, you're going to have doubts, you're going to have concerns, and then at some point, you're going to have consultations with other people, an investigation, potentially the retention of a lawyer, and then the filing of a lawsuit. I'll submit to you, in my experience, if you have an event, if you have that treatment timeline, it's almost impossible to stop doubts and concerns. That's going to happen anytime you have anyone who has an event happen to them or has an event happen to a loved one that they care about. But what you can do is you can break that medical legal timeline before consultation occurs, specifically before consultation occurs with a plaintiff's attorney. Because keep in mind what the answer is going to be that the plaintiff's lawyer is going to give if he or she is consulted. The answer is going to be, this happened because your mom was treated like cattle. The answer is going to be, this happened because they put money first. So ideally, that's where you want to break the chain. And the way you break it, if at all, is really through communication. It's very important to understand what really drives patients to go seek out lawyers. Certainly, I'm not here to tell you that this is not a motivating factor in some cases. And in some cases, it's the primary or the exclusive motivating factor. But in my experience, and I've handled thousands, literally, of lawsuits over nearly 17 years of practice, in most cases, the primary factor is a search for answers. Something has happened, and they don't understand what, or they don't understand why, or both. And they want to understand. They have to understand. And keep in mind, this is the type of search for answers that doesn't just stop. It continues until a satisfactory answer is provided. Nobody goes home at the end of the day and says, gosh, you know, I meant to find out why Mom died in that hospital. I just didn't get around to it. Maybe tomorrow. It doesn't work that way. When you have this type of question, they will continue to look and continue to search. And if you don't provide the answer, they're going to go to somebody who will. And you may not like the answer that that third party provides. This is especially an acute problem in long-term care, because long-term care and end-of-life in general involves issues that people just inherently do not understand. The first of these, quite simply, is human mortality. I don't know of a simpler way to put this. I have a friend and a colleague who's a very preeminent cardiovascular surgeon. He's a friend and a client, excuse me, not a colleague, a client of mine in Houston. He is Iraqi by birth, trained in London, came to the United States probably at about age 40. And he likes to say that Americans are the only people on the planet who think that death is optional. And he's really true. That's really correct. We don't think about it. We don't like to acknowledge it. We certainly don't want to admit that it's ever going to happen to us or our family members. People don't understand that the skin is an organ. I can go tell people that my uncle died of heart failure, and they won't jump to any conclusions about the quality of the care he received at the end of his life. I can say my mom died of kidney failure, and the same things that applies. But you say that someone died of skin failure, which is essentially what a pressure ulcer is, and the automatic assumption in 99 people out of 100 is that shouldn't happen, is that somebody's to blame for that. That's not part of the simple dying process. That's the result of negligence. People don't understand how pressure ulcers develop. It's complicated from a medical standpoint. You all know that much better than I do. What I can tell you is we don't help their understanding by how we explain things. We use a staging system, a numeric staging system, that seems to imply that everything starts as a zero and maybe becomes a one and then a two and then a three and then a four. And why on earth did my mom end up with a four instead of just a one? Couldn't you have stopped it when it was a one or at least a two? We're going to talk more about that in a second. And finally, people don't understand the balancing of end-of-life risks and concerns and goals. And this is especially true when patients are making the transition to palliative care. When you're moving away from the aggressive acute care phase into the end-of-life stage, the goals are different, the expectations are different, and people don't understand this. People don't understand what's likely to happen, and people don't understand what's reasonable to expect and what's not. So, what do we need to do a better job of? We've simply got to do a better job of communicating with families. You've got to manage expectations ahead of time. You've got to talk about long-term care risks. You've got to talk about end-of-life realities. The end-of-life is messy. It can be smelly. It can be unpleasant. There can be weight loss. There can be dramatic changes in appearance. There can be all of these things as part of the normal end-of-life process, and yet we don't want to have that conversation with family members. I'm here to tell you from a medical legal standpoint, you need to find a way to have that conversation with family members. And you need to find a way so they understand the balancing of risks that are associated with treating terminally ill or end-of-life individuals. Because for every treatment that's designed to do one thing, there's usually a risk somewhere else. Let me give you a very quick example. A case I tried about a year and a half ago to a verdict, a successful verdict, involved a man who died from sepsis in some decubitus ulcers he developed. He was a horribly ill man in his early 70s who originally was hospitalized for a bowel obstruction. He was malnourished when he got to the hospital. They fixed his bowel obstruction, but they were very, very concerned about getting his gut moving. So they did not want him on TPN. They wanted to feed him orally. They wanted to try to get his gut moving to give him some semblance of a normal life if he ever got out of the hospital. They made a clinical decision to keep him off supplemental nutrition, to try to get his gut moving. What happened? His malnutrition got much worse. His albumin went way down. He became much more susceptible to pressure ulcers, and in fact, he developed some. But it was an honest trading of risks and rewards. It made sense. The family knew nothing about that. All the family knew was, okay, they didn't feed him, and he developed a bed sore. And guess what happened? We got a lawsuit over the fact that they didn't feed him, and he developed a bed sore. And when you have questions, you simply must have people available to answer them quickly, empathetically, and accurately. It is amazing to me how often questions go purely unanswered, or when they are answered, the answers that are given are just horrible, both from a factual standpoint and a medical legal standpoint. I can't tell you the number of times I see situations where someone will develop a bed sore and they'll come in and ask the nursing staff, how did this happen? And the patient in question is a 90-year-old diabetic with COPD who's malnourished, who was found in an alcoholic coma on her floor. And the nurse's answer is, oh, well, they didn't turn her. Not me. It's the night shift. They're no good. They don't turn them. You know, that's what happened. They didn't turn her. Well, when they get that kind of answer, guess what happens from a medical legal standpoint? So, a particular type of communication that is a hot topic right now and that's on everybody's minds is apologies, and I want to talk a little bit about that. I want to show you a couple of graphs from a survey that was published in American Medical News in February of this year. This is a survey of physicians about what would you say if you were in a situation where you needed to apologize. Take a look at the enormous difference between option one in the light blue and option two in the dark blue. Option one, not mentioning there was an error, and option two, explicitly saying there's an error involved. That is a huge difference from a medical legal standpoint, and it's telling to me that so large a group would fall into either group here. It's also telling to me that 3% say they would make no reference at all. I think that is profound underreporting. I find it hard to believe that 97 out of 100 doctors out there routinely apologize in one way or the other, but that's neither here nor there. Look at another chart from the same survey. How would you say it? Again, notice the huge difference between the dark blue option and the light blue option. I'm sorry about what happened is a very, very different statement than I am sorry. You were harmed by an error. And from a medical legal standpoint, that makes all the difference in the world because although apologies have lots of good benefits, and I am not here to tell you do not apologize, what I'm here to tell you is to do an apology correctly if you do one. Because if you do apologies incorrectly, there are lots and lots of hidden dangers. The first of these is that an apology is always what is called a statement against interest. Now, that is a fancy legal term, which means that the statement is not considered hearsay under the rules of procedure, and that'll be true in any state in the country. What that means is the statement can be repeated in court by anyone who claims to have heard it. Usually, out-of-court statements cannot be repeated because they are hearsay. They're not admissible. But an apology, because it's against your own interest, anybody who claims to have heard it, the person you made it to, the family member who was standing there, the person on his cell phone who happened to be in the waiting room, anybody they can find who claimed they heard you say it can come into court and say, that's what she said. Sometimes an apology can be a legal admission if it is specific enough and if you have the right qualifications medically, you can actually admit liability through an attempt to apologize. If you're capable of doing it and you say it specifically enough, in some jurisdictions, under the right circumstances, this can be a binding admission, which would mean, under the worst case scenario, your lawyer would be precluded from challenging it. You would not be allowed to introduce evidence to contradict your own prior voluntary legal admission of fault. That can happen. It's more theoretical than the first option, but it's very, very real. And another thing that's very real is it can be a bar to your insurance coverage. Under virtually any insurance policy, whether or not you're an institution or an individual, if you read the fine print, you have an obligation to effectively cooperate in your own defense. You cannot sabotage your defense when your insurance company is on the hook for the cost of defense and for the indemnity payment if, in fact, you settle or you lose. If you do something like make a statement against interest, like make a legal admission that jeopardizes your own defense, your insurance company can pull your coverage. And suddenly you are faced with no coverage for the expenses and no coverage for the indemnification liability potential. So how do we apologize effectively? Acknowledge the event, not the fault. Express regret. Take steps to minimize further harm, because again, that's what people are interested in. They want to know what's going to happen, and then explain what happens next. Don't just say, "I'm sorry." That doesn't solve the search for answers. You've got to explain what happens next. Otherwise, they're going to go to somebody else to find out what should have happened next, because the assumption is going to be that nothing happened next. After that, commit to investigate. Commit publicly. We're going to find out why this happened. Actually do it, because ultimately somebody's going to come back to you and say, "Well, what did you do?" And if the answer is, it's on our list, it's on our next committee meeting, we're going to get to it in 6 months, that's not really going to be effective. And then provide continuing feedback and support, because the whole purpose of this process is to make sure you stop the search for answers before the consultation with the lawyer. You want to continue to provide feedback, continue to provide support and provide answers, so that patient or that patient's family does not feel it is necessary to go to that third party that you don't want them to go to. So, effective apologies establish empathy but not liability. They are never spontaneously emotional, because word choice matters. Words have meaning. It's simple to say, but it's very true. No, never more true than in the case of apologies. So, with communication, you must manage your expectations before you can deliver satisfactory results. You've got to provide answers to your patients or your adversary's will, and you must educate and support your staff to effectively communicate with the patients or their families. Now, if you can't cut off the timeline at consultation, you do have one more opportunity, and that's here, before the case is actually retained, before it actually gets on a lawyer's docket. So the next question to ask yourself from a preventative legal care standpoint is, how do patients become plaintiffs? Well, the simple answer, and the not very helpful one, is that a lawyer takes their case. That leads me to the real question, which is, why do lawyers take cases? And it's not really for a lot of the reasons that people think. It's not necessarily because of poor care. Poor care, as we've seen in the University of Michigan study, is not necessary. A lot of times lawyers have to take cases before they even can really evaluate all of the nuances of the care, because if they don't take it, somebody else is going to, and they lose the opportunity. It's not because the case is a winner. Law is an art as much as a science. There is no real winner in most cases. Most cases settle. Most cases involve an economic decision of some sort. So the idea that a case is a winner or a loser at this early stage is not really a viable concept that plaintiff's lawyers use. The simple and single reason that most plaintiff's lawyers take cases is that, because they deem it likely to produce revenue. Now, I say that, and let me say up front and unequivocally, I do not mean this as a disparaging comment against my colleagues on the plaintiff's bar. Far from it. I don't work for free either, or at least I try not to. The law is a business as well as an art, and in this country, plaintiff's attorneys, for the most part, take cases on what are called contingency fee basis, which means that they front all of the expenses, which can be tens of thousands or hundreds of thousands of dollars, depending on the complexity of the case, with absolutely no guarantee of even getting their money back, much less making any income off the case, unless the case produces revenue somehow, some way. It's a simple imperative. Plaintiff's lawyers go out of business if they take cases that don't produce revenue. And if you're wondering about this, ask yourself about the situation where you have a long-term care facility or another corporate entity in bankruptcy. Bankrupt defendants cannot be sued, and they certainly cannot be recovered against. So for the most part, and you'll ask any plaintiff's lawyer, they'll tell you this, the care can be absolutely egregious at a bankrupt institution, and virtually no plaintiff's lawyer will take that case because there is no opportunity to recover revenue from that lawsuit. So, understanding that, the key point is to understand how a plaintiff's lawyer makes the decision on whether or not a case is going to produce revenue. And to understand that, you have to understand the information that's available to a plaintiff's lawyer when he or she makes this decision. He's got the patient and the patient's family, often emotional, often unreliable, almost always lay people. Then he's got the medical record. And really, that's it. That's all he or she has. It's not until after the lawsuit is filed that he or she gets to engage in written discovery and take depositions and develop the case in a way that really reveals the facts. So the medical record is absolutely key in this important, almost outcome determinative decision the plaintiff's lawyer has to make. Thinking about that, remember not only that the medical record is always the first thing a plaintiff's lawyer sees, it's always going to be used without two very key sources of information that you take for granted: the clinical team and the patient himself or herself. The record is being used in a fashion that it was never intended to be used. It's never intended to be the sole source of information. If you want to know something that may not be in the medical record, you can turn to a teammate, you can turn to another nurse, you can turn to another member of the clinical team to ask them, or you can turn to the patient himself or herself, who is the best source of information. The plaintiff's lawyer cannot do that, and that leads to certain conclusions from the medical record that create legal risk. And the first of these is that something is not documented, it's not done. I hate this. I know they teach it all the time in nursing school. I understand why it's taught. From a medical legal standpoint, it's simply not correct. And think about it. In a vacuum, here's why. In a vacuum, there's three possibilities in terms of care, and all three are equally likely. Something can be documented and done. Something can be done but not documented. Something can be documented but not done. And they're all three equally likely. You can't judge anything about what actually happened by what happened in the documentation. It's a separate event. An even more dangerous assumption is not documented, not known. If the wound size is not documented, that means critical decisions were made that day without that information. If the wound color is not documented, if the patient's vital signs are not documented, that means nobody knew it. That means whatever decision we're going to second guess must have been made with incomplete information. So what you end up with is the idea that charting errors create the appearance of negligent care. And in the medical legal context, I'm afraid to tell you, appearances are what matters at this stage. This is where medical legal litigation really differs from a lot of other types of litigation. For example, airline industry faces tons of litigation. There's tons of litigation over car crashes. No matter how savvy a plaintiff's lawyer is, no matter how wonderfully articulate he or she may be, she cannot look at a jury and convince those 12 people that a plane crashed if it didn't. The plane either crashed or it didn't. But in the healthcare field, that's not true. It happens all the time that 12 lay people are convinced that the plane crashed from a care perspective, when in fact it did not. And usually it's based on these types of avoidable charting errors. The first of these I want to get back to is the staging system. Remember, we talked about this. The way we use the staging system implies an inevitable and a linear progression of wounds. The numeric system itself lends that conclusion to lay people. It allows for erroneous and dangerous misperceptions, that all wounds in the same area are linked, and then more importantly, like we talked about earlier, that all wounds can be stopped at an earlier stage. If it's a 4, why did it get to a 4? It had to have been a 1 at some point, didn't it? Why didn't you stop it then? So, what do we do about that? For the most part, if you can, consistent with clinical care, and remember, everything I'm saying, the caveat is, if consistent with clinical care, chart what you see, not a term you might read in a textbook. Clearly identify wound location and appearance. Don't worry so much about trying to categorize it as a stage 1, a stage 2, or stage 3. A chart when lesions resolve and distinguish between superficial breakdowns, which may be due to moisture, and actual pressure ulcers in your charting. In a nutshell, preventative legal care and charting, minimize checklists when consistent with quality care. Now, I'm not talking about the type of checklist that you might have read about in the Checklist Manifesto, if anybody read that or is familiar with that book. Those are the types of checklists that directly involve clinical care-making decisions. What I'm talking about is the rote documentation checklist. 10,000 boxes in a chart, one box for checking the color of a wound, one box for checking the size, one box for checking that the patient was turned laterally, one box for checking that the bed frame, the bed was in the proper position, et cetera, et cetera. If you'll actually read in the Checklist Manifesto, I think it's in Chapter 7, he actually acknowledges that he's not talking about a documentation system either. So what he's talking about in checklists as a good thing is an apple. This is what I'm talking about is more of an orange here. Minimize the use of confusing and misleading terminology, again, like stage 1, stage 2, stage 3, to the extent consistent with good care. Distinguish between charting variances and care failures. Do not allow charting mistakes to be turned into evidence of care failures, because as we just talked about, they're really not. And finally, understand the risks inherent in your EHR system. Because I know all of you, if you haven't already gone to electronic health records, you're going to go there because the government's already told us we all have to go there, and it's a great thing, and they're going to give us lots of money when we do and withhold money if we don't. So I want to spend just a few moments talking to you about new medical legal challenges from EHR. Very quickly, just some basics that you already know. Electronic health records have exponentially greater volume. You're now going to be storing more records than were ever possible with file cabinets and record rooms and offsite storage facilities. I'll give you an example. A terabyte is a common use. It's a common storage system, or it's common storage amount in an EHR system. Excuse me. A terabyte of data would be 500 million typewritten pages. 500 million typewritten pages stacked on top of each other would be 58 Empire State Buildings. That's how much we're talking about storing now. Electronic records are dynamic. They can change in ways we don't really understand, and they can change over time merely by accessing them in a way that paper can't. A piece of paper stays a piece of paper. What you put into your electronic system doesn't stay the same really at any point in time. And finally, and most importantly, electronic health records contain what's called metadata. Metadata, for those of you not familiar with the term, is information describing the history, tracking, or management of an electronic document. And we're going to talk more about that later. One risk of EHR is that our expectations for it are too high. We've been sold the idea that this is going to be wonderful, we're going to have a lot more accurate records, we're going to provide better care because we're using electronic records. Well, we now have some studies on this that make it clear that that may not quite be the case. Dr. Nebaker at the VA hospital in Salt Lake City did a study of the EHR system the VA was using, specifically studying physician notes. And here's what he found. 84% of the charts he looked at had at least one error. They averaged almost 8 errors per chart. And if you look at some of the examples, these are some of the same types of kind of boneheaded accuracy problems that you see with paper charts. And I would submit to you that the lesson to be learned here is quite simple. If your staff are bad record keepers with paper, they're likely going to be bad record keepers with EHR. The only difference is going to be you're going to be keeping a whole lot more of their bad records for a lot longer period of time than you presently are with paper. The Journal of American Informatics coined the term iatrogenesis, and again, I liked it, so I stole it. This talks about a number of different unique problems associated with the electronic aspect of electronic records from a liability standpoint. I only have time to go through a couple of these, but I do want to touch on them just very briefly. Juxtaposition errors. One thing you see with EHR systems is really long lists of items, long lists of labs, long lists of medicines, long lists of treatment options. These lists are not put together by doctors at the top of their medical class. Generally speaking, they're not put together by doctors at all. They're put together by computer guys who don't know an antibiotic from a narcotic. What they do know usually is their alphabet. So you get long alphabetized lists that aren't very helpful, which can lead to mistakes inherent in trying to find what you're looking for in a particular list. This is only exacerbated when you attempt to actually focus on the patient, not scrolling down multiple computer screens worth of information in your EHR system to try to find the test that you want. Electronic alerts. This is a wonderful idea that has a lot of litigation risk because these are turning out to be like car alarms. People simply shut them off and disregard them. I mean, how many of you out there have ever called 911 when you hear a car alarm? How many of you even turn around to look and see what's going on when you hear a car alarm in a parking lot? Well, guess what? We're finding out that healthcare practitioners are treating these alarms the same way. The Journal of American Medical Informatics did a study on this and found with respect to drug safety alerts, which are pretty important alerts, they were overridden 96% of the time in their study, just simply turned off. And of course, both the alert and the fact that you turned it off is documented in the medical record for anybody later to go see if, in fact, there's a problem. I want to get back to metadata for a second and talk about how this is an important danger. Just for background for some people who may not be familiar with the computer terminology, there's two types of metadata. There's application metadata, which is embedded in a document. It's created as part of the application software, and it can reflect document changes. These are the type of things, for example, in WordPerfect that allows somebody to tell who's revised a WordPerfect document, who has shared it, what revisions were offered and then perhaps not accepted. All that information exists in your EHR system. So if, for example, you want to claim that a particular note was made at a certain time, your EHR system is either going to back you up or prove that you're not telling the truth, because it will capture when that note was created in a way that paper will not. It will likely capture if someone else attempted to add information to the note and was later deleted in the way that, again, paper will not. There's also what's called system metadata. System metadata is important because although it's not embedded in the document itself, it's created by the system in the document creation process. And this is important because the courts are not considering it hearsay, which means that anything you can glean from system metadata is information that can be given to a jury automatically. It's just there. And that leads us to really the key to this, which is the litigation risk associated with this. The first of these is a simple one, what I call authentication failure. Authentication is a simple concept. It simply means proving your document is what you say it is. It's a concept that first-year law students are taught about. We don't even think about it with paper records. But with electronic records, it's becoming more complicated because they are dynamic, because we don't have the assurance that they are what people say they are. So the very idea of your being able to prove your document is what you say it is, a complete and accurate rendition of care given several years ago, comes into question if your electronic system is not properly functioning and if you're not retaining electronic information properly. Record retention error. Remember, I talked about the fact that these documents are dynamic. They're not retained in the same way. You put pen on paper and you got it in terms of creating a paper record. Let me give you an example of how that's not the case with electronic records. This is a real lawsuit. It was actually involved. It didn't go to court because it was part of the Canadian system, but there was real litigation over a neurosurgical event in Toronto last year in which a man came out from what seemed like a routine neurosurgical procedure with a really horrible brain injury. The anesthesiologist maintained everything went fine. Everything was just fine. He had no problems during the procedure. They were using an electronic record system. The problem was that his real-time screen had a cable that connected to the hard drive to the central system that retained the information, and that cable came loose. So roughly 90 minutes of the record of the anesthesia for that procedure was gone and could never be recaptured. And of course, that case settled because there was no way for the anesthesiologist to prove what actually happened during the course of that procedure. The other and even more scary thing is the idea of metadata ambush, what I call. When you turn over documents to the other side in litigation, they're entitled in most jurisdictions, not all, but in most jurisdictions, to pick those documents apart and see what they show from a metadata standpoint. The American Bar Association has already looked at that and said, that's totally appropriate. That's legal. You can do that because they're your documents. You're supposed to know what they say. In that same anesthesia case, interestingly, they had two EHR events in that same case. The surgeon who was involved in that case maintained that he was present in the PACU and he saw the patient come out from anesthesia and the patient was fine then. It must have been a complication later because he was physically present. He didn't remember being physically present there, but he could tell from his note, his post-operative note, that he was immediately after the anesthesia. The problem was they mined the metadata from the system and realized that he wrote his post-operative note an hour before the procedure started. Now, luckily for that physician, that came out during pretrial, during the discovery process. But there's no reason they couldn't have waited until he got on the stand and testified in front of the judge and the jury and told that story to reveal that information. Guess what happens then? Suddenly you don't have a malpractice lawsuit. Suddenly you have punitive damage lawsuit. Suddenly you have criminal liability for civil perjury. If the government's involved, suddenly you have what's called obstruction of justice, which the government frowns upon, if I can put it lightly. All of these dangers exist, and all of them need to be recognized prospectively. So, with respect to your documentation's always going to be the first thing a plaintiff's lawyer reviews. They're always going to use it in ways you don't intend or expect, so you need to prospectively evaluate your documentation system with an eye both towards how it's used for patient care today and how it's going to look to adversaries years later. Turning to the final aspect of preventative legal care I want to talk about, if you can't stop that timeline and the lawsuit's going to be filed anyway and you're going to face a battle, there are still things you can do prospectively to make sure that battle goes as quickly and as easily as you can. Doesn't mean you have to just sit there and wait to get punched in the nose. And really, the most effective ways that you can effectively mitigate risk in advance are through the effective use of photographs, the effective use of representation, and the effective use of privilege. And I want to talk very briefly about all three of these in the time I have remaining. There are lots and lots of common misconceptions about photographs, particularly in long-term care and particularly in wound care. The first of these is that they're Perry Mason moments. For those of you old enough to remember Perry Mason, that at trial you hold up the photograph and somebody jumps up and says, yes, you're right, I did it, it's horrible, the care was bad, I admit it, case is over. It doesn't work that way. That they're too graphic. In today's society, you know, people are watching horrible things on TV all the time. There's very little that we can show juries that they really find to be too graphic to digest. I've never seen a set of photographs in a litigation involving long-term care that would fit that. That they're always damaging. Photographs can, in fact, be helpful, and they are, in fact, helpful in a lot of cases. Or that they're never helpful, the flip side of that. So, in terms of affirmative use, I can't answer the simple question that I'm sure is on a lot of your minds, should I take photographs? And there's a simple reason I can't answer that. It's because I'm not a clinician. There are lots of good clinical reasons to take photographs. And I will tell you, if you have a good clinical reason, take the photographs. But keep in mind the medical legal implications of taking photographs and, consistent with clinical care, make smart preventative medical legal decisions about how you take them if you decide to take them from a clinical standpoint. And that starts with well-written policies on photographs. Keep in mind that every facility needs to consider in advance when it's clinically advantageous to take a photograph and when it's not. Don't simply take them willy-nilly every time that you can. Make sure you have a good policy in place establishing when photographs are clinically advantageous and when they should be considered, not necessarily when they should be taken, because you need to keep in mind that policies should always be guidelines. They should never be rigid rules or regulations. You don't want to ever, unless it's absolutely necessary from a clinical care standpoint, mandate that photographs are taken at certain points in time, because ultimately somebody is going to forget to take the photograph. And always remember, from a medical legal standpoint, a missing photograph is far, far more damaging than a graphic one. If you have a policy that says there must be a photograph taken at X point and there is not one, the argument's going to be cover-up. They knew the care was bad, so they intentionally didn't take the policy when the photograph when the policy said they absolutely should. Avoid that if at all possible, consistent with clinical care. Integration into your EHR. Keep in mind that you have to have a designated record set, and as you're going to EHR systems, you need to make sure that your system can effectively integrate photographs. Photographs take up lots of space. They're hard to digitize. They are costly in some cases to digitize. As you move to EHR, make sure you're not in a situation where you end up having to keep Polaroids in a separate paper folder and an EHR chart elsewhere. First of all, you don't have an integrated chart. Second of all, you're going to lose the photographs, and you're going to end up in the same situation we talked about before with the missing photograph and the conspiracy allegation. And finally, facility control. You simply cannot have nurses with cell phones going around taking pictures of patients or wounds. Shockingly, that happens a lot. I'm sure to nobody in this audience, but I've seen it happen at a lot of facilities. You have a right to mandate who can and who cannot take photographs in your facilities. You need to control that. You need to control that at a minimum from a HIPAA standpoint, because it's a HIPAA security violation if you have nurses going home with patient identifying information in photographs on their cell phones. Again, the federal government frowns on that. Your litigation opponents will frown on that too. Effective representation is, again, something that is often really overlooked. It amazes me how many very highly educated, type A aggressive personalities in healthcare become so meek when they have to get into the legal process and have to get help from people in my profession. Imagine what would happen if somebody came to you and if you needed a heart procedure and you called your insurance company and they said, you know, I've got the right surgeon for your CABG. I've got the right person. She's great. She's the best. She's wonderful. She's had 30 years of experience. She's done thousands of these. Just go ahead and show up at the hospital, and after you're under anesthesia, she'll be there, I promise, and she'll take care of the surgery and you'll be fine. Nobody would do that. And yet, a lot of times we accept that, or you accept that, or something similar to that in litigation. This is not often far from the truth. I see this all the time. The insurance company will tell you, you're getting Jane Smith, who is wonderful, who is the best, who is the smartest, most talented lawyer dealing with long-term care facility litigation ever. And you hear that name, and the name's on the letterhead. And then you have meetings, and it's Kevin Jones, who has 2 years' experience, who's at the meeting, and it's John Wilson, who has 1 year experience, who's at the deposition, and it's somebody else who's doing something else. And you never see the wonderful person that you've hired until it's too late, because the case has gotten too far down the path to be salvageable from a litigation and a liability standpoint. So, what to avoid in your lawyer? The missing man, which is what I just talked about. Make sure you insist in advance that you know who your lawyer really is, who's going to be the one handling the case. Avoid the dictator. Keep in mind, a lot of lawyers think it's their case. It's not their case. It's your case. The final decision on what's a good outcome is your decision. What determines a good outcome is what makes you happy. Your lawyer shouldn't care if you go to trial or you settle. Your lawyer shouldn't care if you settle for X amount or X plus one. They should give you good professional advice and let you make the decision. And finally, the Rambo wannabe. We all want the tough, smart lawyer, the guy who wants to fight over everything, does nothing but enrich his own pockets for the most part, because really all that accomplishes is increase legal fees. It doesn't make your life any better. It doesn't make your case any better. Your lawyer is your sword. Privileges are your shield. And in the 5 minutes I have left, I want to touch just basically on one privilege, which is peer review, and how I see that shield not effectively used. Privilege law is going to vary from state to state, so I can't talk intelligently to everyone in this audience about the specifics. But what I see in numerous states in which I practice is that the shield is not used because peer review is either defined too narrowly. You're not including a lot of clinical issues which really could be privileged. You're not doing a lot of privileged activities such as counseling within the protected peer review process. And you're using a document retention system that simply throws away a privilege that might ordinarily exist. That's really the key. That's like creating the shield, arming yourself, and then just putting it down and walking into battle without it. It doesn't make any sense from a medical legal standpoint. Privilege waiver. Common causes of privilege waiver, again, from jurisdiction to jurisdiction, include improper committee structure. You just haven't looked at your law to set up your system to invoke a particular privilege. Improper document creation. You've got the system in place, but you're not mandating that the people creating these sensitive documents actually do so within your system. Voluntary disclosure of documents. In most jurisdictions, the disclosure of documents that's required by law to joint commission, for example, to a state board, won't waive a privilege. But if you're just handing them out voluntarily, that will waive a privilege. Believe it or not, I see that all the time. And maintenance of records in the ordinary course of business. What by this I mean, lumping otherwise privileged documents into routine files. And the biggest violator here is the routine administrative personnel file. I see time and time again where documents and information that could be privileged is dumped into a personnel file and then disclosed in litigation to the detriment of the healthcare provider. It's really a critical issue because it is so determinative. If you look at the difference between a personnel file and a peer review file from a litigation standpoint, personnel files are always requested. Everybody requests them. Every time you're in litigation, your opponent's going to ask for personnel files. Most of the time, you don't even get a request for a peer review file because they know it's privileged. It's not worth their time. So for those of you worried about defense costs, this is one way to head off a fight before it even starts. Again, personnel files in virtually every jurisdiction are not privileged under any law that I'm aware of. In most jurisdictions, at least some of a peer review file, if not all of it, is going to be privileged. And more importantly, when you're talking about the person who's going to be making these decisions, the judge, in my experience, and I've been doing this for 17 years, if a judge hears the word personnel file, her reaction automatically is the plaintiff gets it, give it to him. The judge hears the word peer review file, the reaction's entirely different. It's 180 degrees different. The reaction is, well, unless I hear something very surprising, the facility is going to keep those documents and the facility is going to keep that information. So, key concepts on mitigation. Be an active participant in your own legal care. Use visual evidence to your advantage. Set up your policies in advance to maximize the medical legal benefit from your clinically advantageous photographs. Insist on proper representation. Do it in advance. Don't wait until you're in the heat of the battle to realize that you've got a warrior or someone representing you who's not the person you expect or not the person that you deserve. And control your own case. You would not give control over your medical care to someone without becoming actively involved. Don't do the same thing with your legal care. And understand state privilege law. Take full advantage of it. Let me stress this as one last final point. A privilege can always be waived. The simple fact that you prospectively maintain a document or a piece of information in a privileged fashion does not change or diminish in one respect what you can do with that document later. It simply gives you options later on down the line because privileges are like toothpaste. Once they come out, they can't put them back in the tube. Once you've waived the privilege, you can't get it back. So it is advantageous to assert it. It's advantageous to prospectively maintain it, then waive it, if you think it's to your advantage from a clinical or medical legal standpoint to do so. So, in conclusion, even perfect care brings litigation risk. You can't avoid it. Keep striving for perfect care. Satisfactory results minimize litigation risk. It is the satisfactory result, not the great result. I have seen many, many cases of an expected death with dignity not leading to litigation. And I have seen many cases of an absolutely miraculous recovery with an unexpected minor complication that have resulted in litigation because that result was not the expected one. Appearances often matter more than reality. That's a sad statement, but a true one. And finally, those of you who are prepared to fight, who take the time prospectively from a preventative standpoint, are those who are least likely to have to fight. And with that, only a few seconds over, I thank you for your time.
Does anyone have any questions for Kevin? Oh, we got one over here. We got two over here, and the mics are coming. Over there. Okay. Solange, you had your hand up, and there was another person over here. You need to run faster. Here you go. Thank you.
How do we deal with family members that are taking pictures with their cell phones? I had dinner with a family member because I realized what was going on. I took her out to dinner to a nice restaurant. She came in with a laptop and opened the laptop to show me some pictures that she took. Mm-hmm. Now, needless to say, I canned that lawsuit. She didn't file after the dinner. But how do we control these things when we don't know who's taking pictures?
That's a great question. And there's only so much you can do. But there are things you can do. Your facility is private property, by the way. You have a right to have control over the use of photographs by non-clinical people for non-clinical reasons on your institution. Now, you may upset clients, you may upset some family members, but there's no legal reason that I'm aware of where you cannot have a policy that says that photography is not allowed except for clinical reasons in the facility. There's lots of good reasons you can justify that. It's a danger to the staff. It can impose, you can capture pictures of staff members and invade their privacy. You can violate HIPAA rights of other patients if other patients are accidentally caught in the background of photographs. So you can have a policy that states that this type of photography is prohibited. I'll give you an example of other places that have those. A lot of psychiatric hospitals have them. A lot of substance abuse facilities have those types of policies for patient privacy and confidentiality reasons. You just can't bring photographic materials in or photographic equipment in. Now, are you going to stop it 100% of the time? No. Is it going to happen? Yes. But if you choose to make the business decision to have the policy in place and you publicize it, you have the sign up in the waiting room about why, you're going to minimize it. It's a business decision. When they take the photographs, when they exist, you know that's going to be unique to a particular family, a particular case. You know, that's not something I can comment on in a general fashion.
My question just has to do with credentialing. Uh-huh. I don't know if that's really specific to the state, but does that work at all? The credentialing process or any practitioner performance review, is that part of peer review?
Credentialing is related to peer review in most states, but it's not the same thing. Credentialing is, you know, specific to physicians, first of all, and to the granting of privileges to perform procedures. So it's a little bit different, but in most jurisdictions, the same types of privileges of confidentiality are going to apply. And it's an interesting dichotomy because in most places that I go, I see absolutely aggressive efforts to protect the confidentiality of physician credentialing information. People go to go to the ends of the earth to protect that information, and yet they turn around and disclose the sensitive nursing clinical information of their staff members by throwing it in their personnel file or otherwise not taking some simple steps to maintain the confidentiality of that information. But the details of how to proceed, how to make them confidential, that's going to vary from state to state.
One more question here.
What about an arbitration or mediation statement in your agreement, admission agreement? What do you think of that?
Well, mediation is never binding, and you almost don't have to have a mediation agreement, because in virtually every state, judges are going to mandate mediation ahead of time before you can get to trial. I'm not aware of any state where in 99% of the cases that's not a mandatory prerequisite to getting a jury trial. Arbitration is not a panacea. First of all, it's not even allowed in certain states. In my state, in Texas, it's against state law to mandate arbitration in a healthcare liability claim. You cannot deny someone the right to a jury trial if it's over a bodily injury, any type of bodily injury resulting from healthcare. There are similar provisions in other states. Keep in mind, though, when you think about arbitration, what you're giving up in the process. You're putting your life in the hands of one individual with no protection of rules of procedure, with no appellate review, with no procedural mechanisms for dismissal of the case short of the arbitration hearing itself. So there are situations where it can be advantageous as a blanket proposition, put it in every agreement, every patient, every time. I would be cautious about that.
Well, maybe put it in, but don't make it mandatory. Maybe make it a separate part of the admission.
You could. I mean, you could conceivably try to put it in. You could put anything in a contract. Depends on whether your state will uphold it. You could conceivably put in an option for the facility, that the facility has the right to initiate arbitration at its election. Most states probably would not enforce that, but some might. If you start trying to arbitrate part of an admission or part of a resident stay, I don't see how that would work. I think you would end up with duplicitous litigation, double your cost, and really potentially inconsistent outcomes. I think that it's going to be, from a case-by-case standpoint, patient-by-patient, resident-by-resident, it's probably an all-or-nothing proposition.
Okay. Thank you, Kevin.
Thank you very much.